Kim and I come up, she said, John, John, that thing about the Spanx. She said, that was our bedroom before we left the house. I went, oh my God, the future queen's got Spanx on it.
It's Magic Breakfast with Lamar and myself, Harriet Scott, and this is a real treat. John Bishop, welcome.
Well, thank you. Thanks for having me.
In the building.
In the building. In the flesh.
You know, I'm always jealous. I want your accent.
You want my accent?
I'm telling you. It's got that, you know, it's just got that. Just got
you
the,
want
the,
my
the,
accent.
The gravitas, the weight to it. You know, when you speak to someone, it's just automatically cool.
Let's just swap. We'll swap for a day. You can walk around with this voice.
With that.
You can walk around with this voice and I'll take yours and just phone me wife and go, hey, hey, babe, where you got on? Where you wearing, babe? Wait,
she'll be like, who's this? Yeah,
Johnny's coming home.
Are you an early morning person ever? I'm finding when I work with musicians, you're all late night people.
Yeah,
you must be a late night person.
You know what's funny actually, because I had a normal job and stuff like that. I've never got out of the normality of getting up early in the morning. And it's one of those things that when you're gigging, you do. And what I do, I don't know about you, but me, I love. In fact, 90% of the reason I go on tour is because when you're on tour, you can justifiably have an afternoon nap. That to me is the biggest joy about saying at 3 o'clock, I'm preparing for my show by going to sleep. So that's the thing. I can get up early, but I've got to have a nap.
Do you commit to the nap, okay?
100%.
Yeah, this is not lying on the sofa telling the kids to be quiet. This is going to bed.
What I heard is Winston Churchill used to do that. Even during the war, he used to get fully undressed, go to bed, lie in the bed, take 10 breaths, and if he wasn't asleep, he'd get back up again. But he'd have a nap every afternoon.
10 breaths?
He used to go 10 deep breaths and then get up.
Okay.
That's what I've heard.
You know, if I ever take a nana nap or a disco nap, I always think you feel rotten when you first wake up.
Absolutely rotten. Yeah.
Clean your teeth and have a cup of tea and you're fine.
Yeah, I don't feel rotten. And also I have a whole routine. Like if I'm in a car, I'm travelling to a gig and I'm in a car, so I'm not in a hotel or anything like that, headphones on, put David Gray, Greatest Hits on by the third song. It's soothing music to me. David hits the notes all the time.
Now you're going out on tour.
You are. So, it's the most
cue
exciting
David Gray.
It sounds like a tour for people who just need to have slowed down. Oh, we spoke about having a nap. It's the least exciting tour announcement ever. Yeah, I am. I am. Next October, I'm celebrating 25 years since my first ever stand-up gig.
25 years?
Mm.
That's a number right there.
It is. So it's not 25 years since I turned professional or anything. Yep. 25 years since I first walked on a stage at the Frog and Bucket Comedy Club in Manchester.
And you're going back there as part of the tour.
I am. I've booked all the arenas plus the Frog and Bucket.
what a gig
that's going to be. That's pretty cool.
It's great, yeah.
That's wicked.
Your career must have taken you know, all around the world and certainly, you know, meeting royalty. You know, what's that like? What's it like when you do the old handshakes at the Royal Variety performance?
Oh, well, it's funny, actually, because I think, let's be honest, having a royal family is bonkers. It's just a ridiculous thing. If we didn't have one, we wouldn't say, I tell you what, we haven't got a royal. If we started a country, we wouldn't say, I tell you what, let's all get together, let's all pay taxes. Oh, by the way, let's get that family and put them in a bigger house than the rest of us. It's stupid.
Do you realise this? There goes your knighthood. Right,
I know.
Here.
So
I'm just saying, that went a long time ago. Fine, just choices.
But what I will say is the members of the royal family I've met as people are, they never chose that life. And they do incredible stuff for this country that you can't really quantify until you try and challenge what it would be like if they weren't there. And so I've met basically all of them.
Yeah.
The funniest one, I did the Royal Variety Show and Charles was there with Camilla. And when you do the Royal Variety Show, you've just got to, as the host, you've just got to fill in. Yeah. And I come on stage And Take That got 90 dancers or something. Wow. And they were trying to get these 90 dancers on the stage, and someone had gone missing, and they're all, and so they just kept on saying, fill in.
No.
So I was like, what the talk about? So I'm filling in, and I started talking about dicky bowls and, you know, the way we were all suited up. And I said, you know, obviously that's for men. Men have got cummerbunds on, which is the male Spanx. It's the thing that pulls you. Then I started talking about Spanx, and I said, you know, if you don't know what Spanx are these things that women wear when they go to the wardrobe, and they've got one of those nasty wardrobes that shrinks the dresses. So that when they try to get into the dress, the wardrobe's shrunk. So you put this Spanx on it, and you get as much of your body in the Spanx as you can. You tuck yourself in, you pull your neck down, you get all yourself in the Spanx. I said, if you want to know which women in this room are wearing Spanx, it's the one with the big master bed. And so, I was just filling in. And then at the end, they come along, and Prince Charles, and then Camilla come up, she said, John, that thing about the Spanx, she said, that was our bedroom before we left the house. I went, oh my God, the future queen's got Spanx on.
That's so good.
But, as I say, I've done various things with the younger royals as well. And listen, they never picked the life that they're in, and they do a lot of good for a lot of people, so good luck soon.
In the
they
tour,
get me nights up back.
Certainly an OBE. Tickets are £25 as well to mark 25 years. Is that so, like a pound shop thing? You know, like, so some of the things are like, so some of the things are really rubbish, and some are really expensive, and they manage to like even it out.
So there'll be some terrible jokes that are in your pound jokes, and I've got some quality, some gold in it. No, you know what it is. I'm on tour at the moment, and it's great, and I'm doing this tour, and I'm in theatres, and I'm loving it. But I wanted to do something in a short space of time, so that's why I'm putting the arenas on. I wanted to do it as a celebration, and I wanted it to be a celebration for the. I've been lucky enough, and I only looked at this the other day. With all of my tours, I've sold nearly 3 million tickets.
Amazing.
And you think, that's mental, isn't it?
That is a lot of tickets.
So that means a lot of people have been, and a lot of people have been once, twice, three, four times, and I'm trying to say to them, just come back, because this is my thank you to you. And the best way of doing that is to make it as easy as possible for people to do it.
Love
that.
I mean, I could have done it for nothing, but I didn't want to make it that easy, you know what I mean?
I looked at your tour dates, and I saw you've given yourself off from the middle of November to the February. It's good forward planning.
Really?
Yeah, I wondered if that was a panto break.
Oh, you mean for this year?
Well, to be honest, I was a bit confused. I didn't realise these tickets were for next year. But
yeah, no, so this year, no, I'm off, because I'm off here. I'm going to Australia in November. So I'm doing Australia and New Zealand in November. In December, and then I've got a holiday in January, and then I'm going to New York, and I'm doing a little run in New York at the end of January, and then I'm back in the UK.
Whoa. You are working. I need to wake up. Let's go to work, Lamar. What's going on?
You gotta get out there, Lamar.
Wow. Okay.
I saw the break and I was thinking, is he gonna go back into panto? No, working elsewhere.
I did one last year with Ian McKellen, and I absolutely loved it. I loved it. Panto's a very joyful thing. It used to be regarded as naff, but it's brilliant. I've done two pantos, one with Ian McKellen, one with Chesney Hawks.
Amazing.
So I would definitely do it at some point.
Would you recommend it?
Good.
Yeah.
Do you know Beverly? I spoke to Beverly Knight earlier, and she was saying, "Oh, she loves it. You have to do it." The month. So
you know what it is? Yeah. It's a thing that's unadulterated joy. You can't do it if you're trying to be a bit snuffy about it. You can't do it if you're trying to like look down your nose at it. Yeah. You have to go, I am here because there's kids in this room who will remember this for the rest of their life. And you get that instant joy.
Oh, brilliant.
That's really cute. Brilliant. I love that. Before you go, can we sense check you? It's a thing we do with our guests. It'll be fine. I promise you. Let's start with smell, okay? What does the front row of a comedy audience smell like?
Well, it depends where it is. And I say that on purpose because I recently did a tour in the States, and I ended up doing this venue in San Francisco where they could order food And so the front row in San Francisco smells of hot dogs and chips, which is the only front row in the world that smells like that.
Hot dogs and chips. All right, what's the other one here? Hearing podcasts, too many or not enough?
You know what I love about podcasts is the long-form interview and people are connected. So yeah, I think as long as people are talking to each other, the world's a better place.
Site, favourite comedy film of all time?
Oh, God. Favourite comedy film of all time? Wow. Anything with Peter Sellers in it.
Yeah.
Anything.
Peter Sellers, yeah, he's pretty comedian.
At the risk of going over time, I'm interested, that maybe it's a stupid question, how did you know you were funny then? Do you know, like, how? when did you think, I'm going to go on stage and I'm going to, you know, be a professional stand-up? Like, if you...
When he came off stage at the Frog and Bucket.
Yeah.
When I did that first ever gig, because I never planned to do it, and I only did it because it meant I didn't have to pay the entrance fee, and I got off stage. I did. It was £4 to get in, and the guy said you don't have to pay if you put your name down.
Oh my God!
Because it's an open mic. I didn't even know what open mic meant.
No,
honestly. And so I just thought, well, I was getting divorced, and I thought, well, that's £4 she's not getting. So I put my name down. And I got up, and then when I got off, the compere was a comedian called Mick Ferry, and he just said, you should come back and try have another go at this.
And look at that.
Jeez.
Yeah.
That's brilliant.
That's literally my sliding doors moment.
That's crazy. That's a great story. Taste. Worst thing you've ever eaten after a gig when all the shops are shut?
Now, the important thing here is I'm vegetarian. And because I'm vegetarian, when I was doing the circuit, you couldn't get any food because all the late night food, as you know, on the roads, kebabs and meat based and all that stuff. So I've always got a little Marks and Spencer's little salad-y thing to have afterwards.
Look at
because
that.
There's nothing out there for people of my nature.
And finally, on your sense check, touch, what's the worst texture in the world? I can't believe anyone's asked you that before. I wouldn't know how to answer that. The worst texture.
The worst texture.
Yeah. What would you just be like?
Who's come up with these questions? Oh my God. Yeah, I'm going through my head thinking, you know what I think is the worst thing? Blancmange.
Yeah, it's a good call.
You know, you look at blancmange and you think, I'm going to put that in my mouth. It's just like wobbly and horrible, isn't it? Cold, solid custard is horrible.
Thank you. We will promote your tour as well, but we got you down.
I like the fact that I've learned something about myself.
I love it. John Bishop, thank you so much for being on Magic
Breakfast.
No, thanks for having me.